Hello, this is Vasu Madabushi at the Rework Deep Learning Summit in San Francisco 2019. And I'm an independent writer. I write a lot about AI and edge computing and AI for good in particular. And today we have Thomas Simonini, who's here to talk about curiosity-driven reinforcement learning. He teaches curiosity-driven reinforcement learning, and I'd like to introduce Thomas. Thomas, can you tell me a little bit more about your very unique background, having come from a political science bachelor's background and having trained yourselves through AI, and now you're teaching AI, which is fantastic. Please tell me a little bit more about yourself.
Sure. So, in fact, I have a bachelor's degree of law and political sciences, French law and political sciences.
Wonderful.
And it was in 2016. At that moment, in fact, I discovered what was machine learning because one of my friends created a startup and he wanted to use machine learning to classify a news article in order to provide news articles based on user taste. And I began to be very interested about that. And it was at the end of my bachelor's degree, so at this moment, in fact, I decided that I want to do AI. I want to study AI. So after my bachelor's degree, I quit university. And I began to self-study. In the first time, at the beginning, I began to self-study mathematics because I was not a math guy at all. So, and there is some resources online with MIT open coursework, etc. So I began to study calculus, linear algebra. And then I signed up at Udacity, Deep Reinforcement Deep Learning Foundation Nanodegree, and Artificial Intelligence Nanodegree. And at the end of that, I decided to learn about Deep Reinforcement Learning, which was not included in the Udacity's formation. And so when I began to study Deep Reinforcement Learning, I was a little bit ill at ease with the fact that the most resources were there was too much mathematics, and there was not a big picture to really understand the concept before diving on the mathematical mm-hmm. details. And consequently, I decided to begin to write articles about that. And in the beginning, it was just one article about introduction to reinforcement learning, and it performed really well. So I decided to continue, and now it's 9 articles and 9 videos, and they are totally free and open source.
Great, great, great. But what kind of really sparked your interest in AI and deep learning in particular? You talked about having gone and trained yourself in more math, and then the progression there. What kind of sparked that interest in AI?
In AI, because I think first is was everything related with robotics. I was completely amazed when I saw the result of Boston Dynamics and that kind of elements. And then the thing that really amazed me early in the beginning was everything related with DeepMind, the result with deep Q-learning, etc. And I was really amazed to see that agents were able to play video games. So it's really how I started to learn AI. And that's why now I'm specialized in deep reinforcement learning, because in fact, I really wanted to be specialized in this particular section. Compared to computer vision or NLP, etc.
Okay, excellent. So tell me a little bit more about your current work, especially with respect to curiosity-driven reinforcement learning. How is that coming along?
So, in fact, I'm currently in the area because I'm currently looking for a job. Because I have a job proposal in France, but I want to find a job in the area. So I currently don't have a job. But I use curiosity-driven learning in my course, in deep reinforcement learning course, because it's the last part of the course, in fact.
So you teach curiosity-driven reinforcement learning?
Yes.
How has the response been from people that have come and taken the course from you?
People are really amazed by this new strategy in deep reinforcement learning. In fact, what is really interesting is that in the beginning, when people read the articles, they don't understand how it's possible that an agent will be the learner and the master in the same time. But then when they understand the system, they're really amazed because the results are very fantastic. We create an agent that learns to play Super Mario Bros. With only this type of rewards and is able to perform very great. It's really amazing.
Okay, great. Now, curiosity-driven reinforcement learning. I mean, is this a new concept or has it been around? Is it catching up? Can you kind of drill down a little bit more on curiosity-driven reinforcement learning itself?
Sure. In fact, curiosity is not a new thing. It was developed in the 90s by the work of Schmidhuber. Mm-hmm. But in fact, the use in deep reinforcement learning is quite is relatively new. It started in 2016-2017. In fact, the idea was because in reinforcement learning we have a big problem because first, reinforcement learning agents, the only feedback that the reinforcement learning agents receive is a reward. This is the only way to learn something, you know, to have a feedback about the action taken. Mm-hmm. The problem is that in most real world environment, most of the reward equals zero. So there is no information. It's what we call sparse reward. And in fact, it was a big problem in deep reinforcement learning since a long time. And curiosity is really a way to avoid this problem by having a new reward function that will really help our agent to explore its environment. That's why it's so promising and why there is so much paper that are published about that, because there are different ways to calculate it, different strategies that we can use.
So in effect, you're creating a trained agent that will provide the reward for the reinforcement learning, the loop, right?
Yes.
So can you look at it as a sort of like a teacher?
Yes. In fact,
you know, you always talk about learning part, but the flip side of it is you know, how effectively can you teach something or anything to learn better?
Yes.
Right? Can you elaborate a little bit more on that?
So in fact, the idea with everything related with curiosity is that you have your agent, which is a learner. So it can be any architecture that you want. So I will not die on that, but PPO, deep learning, what you want. And on the other hand, we have a new model, which will be, in fact, the teacher, if you want. It's this module that will generate curiosity. Mm-hmm. So in fact, the combination of the two makes that our agent will be totally independent in learning, you know. Because the problem nowadays is that most of the reward that are not intrinsic, so the reward function, normal reward function, are implemented by human. And the problem is that it's hard-coded. So when it's video game, it's not a problem because in video game, you know, you have sometimes score. In all video games, you have score, so you can use this score function. But the problem is when we are in real-world situation, you don't have a kind of pre-built function. So it means that it's human that needs to implement it by hand, which is not scalable at all. So that's why it's a promising strategy.
Okay. So do you? What are some of the biggest challenges you're seeing in your current line of work? Trying to adopt this curiosity-driven reinforcement learning, especially when put to actual use, it's solving a specific problem. You talked about video games, right?
Yes.
What are some other bigger challenges?
I think the biggest challenge with that is it's always the same thing. It's generalization first. It means the problem we have currently with reinforcement learning, whatever problem you have, is you train your agent in a specific environment. Mm-hmm. The problem is that we don't know yet how to generalize. It means you train, for instance, if I take our, because it's simple to take a video game. An example, if you play, for instance, a level of Sonic the Hedgehog, and then you want to see if the agent will perform well in another level of this game that is not trained on, it will be not very good, you know. So this is the first problem in big problem. And second problem, I think, is the fact that it takes a very long time to train. Whatever architecture you use, you need to have a lot and a lot and a lot of samples. And this is still a problem because, for instance, for my workshop, I trained for 21 hours with high GPU, and it was still not enough, you know. So well, the second problem is that you spend a lot of time to train something but can't generalize.
Okay. So from a compute perspective, right? Does this require more compute to be able to generate models in a reasonable amount of time? Or does it speed up the whole process of generating a model? Right? You know, the faster time to market, right? You know, that if you can get this out, the sooner you can go and iterate over it as well, so that the models start improving over a period of time.
Yes, and I think the problem is that we really need to find a way to optimize the training for this agent, because even if computation is faster and faster, you know, we have a lot of innovation in computation, mm-hmm. so with GPU, with TPU, etc. I think we also need, you know, to have another way of a new way of training in order to really have faster training, because it's a big problem nowadays. Because it takes too much time, and for sometimes results are good, you know, but because it can't generalize, it means that if you want for real world environment, the problem is that you will need to train a lot and a lot and a lot for not really good results, you know. So there is still a lot of work to do.
Okay. Now, which industry do you see the biggest transformation happening in the coming years? I mean, not specific to curiosity-driven reinforcement learning, but in general. Where do you see maximum bang for the buck?
I think in healthcare, because in healthcare there is a lot of innovation. You know, there is demand health with cancer detection, high illness detection, which are fantastic way, because we all know that the sooner the cancer is detected, the better it is for the cure. Mm-hmm. And so I really think that everything related to healthcare will be really important in artificial intelligence, because it's a big problem in our society. And so I really think that it's it's where AI will have the biggest impact and the biggest positive impact. What I mean, because
so in terms of not AI taking over completely, in terms of let's say if you're looking at radiology, mm-hmm. right? Looking at a lot of MRI or mm-hmm. CAT scan images, it's going to help your radiologist do a better job, you know, in terms of faster time to detection.
Yes.
Reducing number of false positives or false negatives. Mm. Do you think from that perspective, this is going to help a lot?
Yes, I really think that it will help a lot. But the problem is that AI will have an impact, because AI is a technology, but the problem is that we must not forget that AI will not solve all human problems, you know. Because I always hear people saying AI will solve everything, but most of our problems, in fact, are not technological problems, are mm-hmm. politics problems. For instance, when we speak about healthcare, I said that what's good is that it will help people to find sooner the cancer, etc., in order to have a cure. But the problem is that, for instance, in the United States, most of people can't afford to go to hospital. And so the healthcare problem is not solved because you create a technology. Even if this technology is perfect, if people can't afford to have access to this technology, we will solve nothing, except for people who can afford to.
So if this can actually help reduce the cost of providing medical care,
yes,
then you have it's a great cost, right?
Mm, yes.
Right? Wonderful. Think about AI for social impact, right? How can some of your work be applied towards industries that are targeting for social good?
I think in education.
Education, okay.
Because of a deep reinforcement learning course. I think my work have an impact on, the impact that I can have is on education. Because my idea was really to help other people to have access to a course that is simple and free, and that really help them to understand the main architecture, because reinforcement learning is quite a complex topic, you know. And in fact, something important in this topic is to really understand the main elements. And the second problem is that it's, you know, it's very changing topic. There is a lot of things that we thought that were true, but now they are false, etc. Mm-hmm. So that's why I really think that I have an impact in education with this course, because I hope to provide solid foundation for people who want to learn deep reinforcement learning.
Okay. Now, if you notice, you know, in the press and in conferences, there's a lot of talk about the ethics of AI, mm-hmm. and how inherent biases kind of permeate themselves into models unwillingly, right? Yeah. Unwittingly, inadvertently. You know, how do you think, as a society, we are making some good progress towards, improving, our models so that they are not biased?
Yes. In fact, yes, bias is a big problem. You know, there is some AI result that were a little bit scary. I hear about the AI that detect if or the sexual orientation of people based on the face. And I think this, everything related to that is not a good thing. The problem is that nowadays, our AI can be biased because the data is, you know, very biased in data. Mm-hmm. For instance, there was an article that explained about criminality, you know, how you detect someone who is criminal. And the problem is that because the data is made in, the data made, you know, it's intrinsically biased, the problem is that the AI will learn this bias. So I mm-hmm. think there is a lot of work to do in order to sure. avoid that, because if we create models that have that kind of bias, it will not improve our society, because we'll continue to perform, you know, stereotypes, etc. So yes, but there is a lot of people who work on finding strategy in order to avoid that, but it's mm-hmm. a very hard topic.
Okay, now just switching topics, you know, how does your typical work day look like?
My typical work day when I'm in France, because here it's yep. quite different. Uh-huh. I think it's quite normal. I have a morning routine, so I wake up at 6 p.m. and then I spend my day in a co-working in Lyon. So because I live in Lyon, it's a French city, mm-hmm. and so I what I do is that my morning is focused on education. Because it's where my brain is the more focused, you know. So I really love to upgrade my skills, you know. So read new papers, you know, to keep up the pace of innovation in deep learning. And the afternoon is work, is everything ready to work. So improve the course, side projects, job interviews, etc. And so I normally finish my day at about 6 or 7 p.m. And then, you know, going to work to after works or things like that. Okay. There is okay. a lot of people in France. It's very common, you know, to do that.
Wonderful. So before we sign off, how has the rework Deep Learning Summit here in San Francisco been? You know, have you been able to meet a lot of people, network, you know, go to a lot of different sessions here? What's your general impression about the summit?
Yes, it's an amazing summit, to be honest. There is a lot of very interesting workshop, speech, etc. I meet a lot of people, and people are really friendly. You know, there is a lot of exchange, etc. It's really amazing. So I'm really happy to be here, because I was able to share my knowledge with a lot of people, and I was able to learn a lot of things from other people. So it's really amazing.
Wonderful. I'm really curious about curiosity-driven reinforcement learning. I'm going to go and do a little bit more digging up on it and try to find out more. Thank you so much for your
Thanks.
Time today, Thomas, and have a wonderful rest of the week here in San Francisco.
Thank you very Take much. Care.